All right, I'm here with my buddy Ruby, and in this video we're going to talk about some of the things that we recommend. People are always asking us, yes, well, I have something that I'm going to recommend for you to keep you in the shot. People are always asking us in puppy class what supplies and stuff we use. We actually have a supplies page that is linked in the puppy class parents page. It should be pinned to the top. So you can check that out, and it has links to where you buy the stuff on Amazon and Chewy. The first thing I'm talking about is not what I intended to, but it's a bully stick. This is a part of a bowl that makes a male bowl a male bowl. Well, I guess one of the three parts, but this is the pee-pee. And so this is a bully stick. This is a bully bite. We like the ones that come from the Natural Dog Company. There's a company called Natural Dog Company. They sell balms. Now, word of caution, there are a couple companies that are actually selling bully sticks, and they're advertising them as bully sticks, but they have a rawhide wrapped around the bully stick. Rawhides are something we absolutely stay away from. I learned about this from our friends at the Green Spot, one of our favorite stores in Omaha. Rawhides are actually soaked in formaldehyde, bleach, and ammonia to make them look really nice for us for appearance-wise. But because your dog's ingesting them, that's really not healthy. Also, they're not very digestible. A bully stick is highly digestible. If it gets caught in the dog's digestive tract, the body is going to break it down anyways. Rawhides frequently get stuck because they're about the same exact size as the dog's digestive tract. Also, the dog slobbers and gets it wet and chews and gets pieces. Eventually, they want to swallow that last part, which is not fully soft, and that can create an obstruction. I've had several clients who actually have had puppies and adult dogs where it becomes an obstruction. They have to go in for surgery, and it could be fatal if you don't treat it. So I just would never give my dogs rawhides ever. But there's also, you can give your dogs cow's ears, no hides. One of my dog's favorites are kneecaps. It's the cow kneecap. I like the cow kneecap because that's good for about 5 different chewing sessions. A bully stick, they're pretty much going to go through in one session. Same thing with a lot of those others. Now, I'd probably give them no more than one of those ingestible things a day, but a bully stick can actually, it's actually about this big. The bully bites are this big. Usually they come in 6-inch and 12 inches. For like a small dog, a corgi-sized dog, or a terrier, I'd probably get a 6-inch one. And then for a bigger dog, I might get the 12-inch one. They also make them braided, so they last a little bit longer. These are great things, especially if your dog's very chewy and nippy. When a guest comes over, to give them a bully stick or something along those lines, gives them something to keep preoccupied. That is really important to do, because what it's helping the dog do is practice not jumping up on your guests, not mouthing your guests and the furniture and the rest of that stuff. So those are great things to pair with visitors to your house if your dog likes to jump up and has inappropriate behavior. Also, chewing and licking release endorphins, which are the pleasurable things that go into the dog's brain. And those are really important to give your dog, especially at times they might be a little bit stressed. Allowing them to chew also allows them to release a little bit of that tension and pressure. Now, this is a lick mask, and this is from Best Buddy. And I like the one from Best Buddy specifically because you see on the back, it's hard to see, but these little suction cups are the best suction cups I have ever seen in my life. They're like octopus. You put them on anything, they stick to anything. This is a great thing to use if you're giving your dog a bath. Smear peanut butter over it, stick it to your tile. Your puppy licks this while you're giving a bath. They don't care that you're giving a bath because they're getting yellow peanut butter. I would give them put the peanut butter in first, the first one or two times. After that, you can start freezing it. It makes it last a little bit longer. You can also take like their kibble, soak it in water, and then after about an hour, it'll get. You can mash it up like mashed potatoes. You can put that stuff on there. That's not going to stick quite as well. But if your dog doesn't like peanut butter, it's another alternative. There are other things you can stick to these as well. This is a great thing to do. I recommend these highly. You can also give your dogs like Kongs. A lot of people don't know that Kongs come in two different durabilities. The red Kongs are not as strong as the black Kongs. So if you have a Hardee's chewer, you might want to get a black Kong. Fill that sucker up with peanut butter. Anytime that you have a device that you're going to fill up with things, make sure it has at least two holes. It would be the big hole. There needs to be a small hole to prevent on the other side to prevent it from becoming a vacuum. I've had clients whose dogs had cheap knockoff versions, got their tongues stuck in it, swelled up, it would create a lot of problems. The reason I like the Best Buddy, I don't get any kickback from these guys, by the way, but the reason I like these is because these suction cups are so strong, most dogs will try to take this and walk away with it. They can't do it with the suction cups. So this is a great one to get. This is a small treat. This is the mini treat bag from PetSafe. I'm going to actually ask Laura to hand me hers so I can show hers. This is the mini one. I prefer this kind of as a little bit smaller. The reason I like this, it's got a belt that you can actually put around so you can clip it to yourself, but it also has a clip. So you can actually just simply put it on, attach it to your belt or your pocket or whatever it is. There are a lot of treat pouches out there. The reason I like this one specifically is you only have 2 seconds to get that treat into your puppy's mouth. This one, the nice thing about this one is it's got a couple pockets. One of them, when you open it, it's got a metal thing here and it keeps it open like this. You want to close it? Really easy to close as well. No treats are gonna fall out. It's also got a little Velcro thing, so it's got a separate pocket where you can put different types of treats in there. It's lined so that you can actually put the treats in there, and it's gonna keep your treats a little bit safer. But the thing about this, the reason I like it, is the dexterity. If I have this down on my belt and I wanna give the dog a treat, I can go like this and get the treat out. I see a lot of them that are kinda like buckets or, I don't know, sacks. And I find when people are trying to pull those things out, it takes them a good 10 seconds to get the treat out of there. You've way blown your 2 second window. So this is the mini one that I like because it's small and small shaped. Laura's is the large version of it, and it comes in red, black, and blue. But it's, again, great because you can fit a whole bunch of treats in there. You're gonna give your puppy a whole lot of treats over the course of training them. And if you are like me, and you, before you get one of those things, you just decide, I'm gonna use my nice sweatshirt from Santa Barbara. Well, your puppy will make it holy like this when you leave it on the floor, which is what my dogs did. So to keep your stuff safe, I've had a lot of clients, they have treats in a leather jacket, and the dog shreds a leather jacket because they leave it hanging on a door. It's common for us to do this. Having this makes it really easy. You can grab it when you go out to take a walk. When you come to puppy class, have one of these things. Again, you're gonna be able to get those treats to your puppy within that 2 second window, which is super duper important. So this is the mini treat pouch from PetSafe, or you can get the large one, like I said, the Laura sized one. When it comes to treats, this is our go-to high value treat. Now, I recommend you have 3 levels of treats. We like a cookie treat, it should not be milk bone, I'll talk about that in a second. Then we like a mid-level treat, and a good middle-level treat that we really like is the Charlie Bears. They come in different flavors and they have a coating, so when you throw them on the ground, you can hear them. They're a little bit of a hybrid between crunch and a meat treat. And then I like to use like a cookie treat. Now, I don't like using milk bones because milk bones, pepperoni, bacon strips, and snossages are 4 of the 5 most popular dog treats in America. All 4 of them have known cancer-causing ingredients in them that have been outlawed by the FDA, but not the USDA, which has much more relaxed standards. 1/2 of all dogs die of cancer. So I'm not giving my dog anything that has anything. Yellow dye number 5 leads to hyperactivity as well as a known carcinogen, things along those lines. So anything that looks overly processed, it looks like Play-Doh or something like that, stay away from that. The better quality ingredients that you feed your dog, you're gonna have less health issues, the obstructions and the reactivity issues are gonna be far, allergic reactions are gonna be far less. And it's again, the better quality food that you feed your dog, actually less poop will come out of your dog. So there's a benefit to feeding that as well. A lot of people go to Costco and get really low end stuff. When it comes to the ingredients of anything that you buy, something again I learned from the folks at the Green Spot, they're gonna list the ingredients in the percentage that they are in the food. So if you're buying lamb and rice food, the first 2 ingredients should be lamb and rice. And if it says lamb meal, that's typically the part of the animal that's, not always, but usually that's the part of the animal that is hard to get, and they usually have to wash it with ammonia to make it processable. And they're like, well, they're dogs, they can eat it. Well, I love my dog. I want my dog to be with me a long time, and so I'm gonna feed him better quality food. Now, the Green Spot really likes feeding raw food, a raw diet. Now, raw is a little bit of a misnomer. It's not processed, is maybe, I think, a better way of saying it, because it is actually usually frozen. And you're gonna take it out of your freezer, you're gonna let it warm up. Always make sure you let your dog's food warm up. The temperature of dog food is more important to them than the taste. Smell is number 1. So let it warm up to room temperature, or you can add some warm water to eat into your dog's dry kibble. It's a nice way to get them eating it. So the other one that we really like, if these don't work, the tricky trainers, and these also have very few preservatives, so when you use these, make sure you burp all the air out of the bag, otherwise they'll be hard as an M&M the next time you open it up. This is Stewart's freeze dried beef liver. Dogs fiend for these. We actually have a joke about a nickname that we use for them because they like them so much. And so it doesn't really matter if Martha Stewart or Rachel Ray's treats or their Vogue, it's what your dog likes. So if you go to a nice spot, like a place like the Green Spot, often they have little sample bags. If you ask them, hey, my dog's finicky, do you have any sample bags of treats? You'd be amazed. You might walk out of there with 25 different bags of treats. When you do that, pull a couple out. See how, rate your dog's response from 1 to 5, maybe 5 being the best, and then find the ones that your dog actually really likes. It's important important to have a high enough value treat. Now, be aware of your dog's weight. For puppies, it's kind of hard to overfeed a puppy. You can, but be aware of that. Maybe you substitute a little bit of their food on a heavy training day, and there's absolutely nothing wrong with using their kibble as a training reinforcement or a treat, because that's the nutrition they should have. Now, for puppies, make sure they are in a puppy blend or a puppy formula or a puppy designated puppy food until they're at least 9 months. For older, larger breeds, it's even longer than that. So check with your veterinarian, and you can also talk to Suki or the great folks at the Green Spot or any high-end pet store, and they can kind of help you out, come with different things that'll types of food that are going to be beneficial for your particular type of dog. Now, feeding your dog, this crazy looking thing is called the snuffle mat, and I love these things. This is the one, if you Google Amazon snuffle mat, this will be one of the ones that comes up. This is about $35. You see, Ruby even has no food, and she's interested because it's how these tassels that move. Movement attracts dog's attention. Well, if a dog has to use its nose to get things, that is draining for them. It is also stimulating and relaxing. So if you take your dog's dry kibble and work it into these tassels, I've got to use my nose, find the piece of kibble, move the tassel, lick it up, and repeat that 100 to 300 times. This makes feeding your dog almost equivalent to a walk. Not quite, but pretty close. You should be feeding your puppy at least 4 times a day. So if you're feeding out of this, that's definitely equivalent to at least one walk. So if you have a high energy dog like a Lab or a Doodle or a Dalmatian or a Vizsla, I would highly recommend you get something like this. I also like to feed my dog out of treat dispensing toys. This is one of my favorites. This is the Omega Paw Treat Ball. It's got a little sleeve in here, but it's not just a hole. It's got a sleeve too. So the dog has to roll it just right to get the kibbles to come out. So I put my dog's kibble in it. This is a good thing for them to do because it helps with their problem solving. It also is a nice thing for, it slows down the feeding process. Same thing with the snuffle mat, but it also helps them. Like I have a dog named Max that actually blew out his knee. I fed him out of this. This is a nice way for him to get some low impact exercise, nudging this thing around the room. Now, you might have to roll this the first couple times, but after a while, dogs kind of figure it out. Now, for the snuffle mat and treat dispensing toys, and there are a whole bunch of different types of these. This is one of my favorite ones, but give ones in different shapes and sizes so the dogs have to work on different types of puzzles to figure it out. However, when you hear there's one piece left in it, a lot of dogs will tear this thing open when there's only one piece or when there's no pieces to figure out what's broken because it's been giving me treats the whole time. So give these under supervision. As soon as the food is gone, remove them from the area. Otherwise, you're gonna have to pay for them. And any toy that your puppy gets, if they're chewing pieces of it off, you should remove that toy. A lot of dogs ingest plastic and all sorts of other stuff, and it's a bad habit to start. And also, it's dangerous for them to do so. So avoid those sort of things as well. Now, we talked in another video about harnesses. If you have a fearful dog, we really want your dog to wear a harness instead of a collar. A collar can actually amplify fears for a lot of dogs. And so I would prefer to have a harness that is an X or a Y shape. So it's gonna be kind of draped like this. Sometimes they're like almost a whole thing with like a holes that you put in, but there's a little bit of a dip here. You wanna avoid one that's a T shape that has a going all the way across, because that can impede their movement. If it is a harness, I prefer to get a harness that has a clip here in the front. A lot of them have a front and the back. If you only put it on the back and the dog pulls forward and you pull back or you just hold the leash, you're gonna activate their opposition reflex and they're gonna pull stronger or harder. So I would recommend not using that, getting a front clip harness for those sort of pulling dogs. Or hire us and we'll come and teach your dog how to walk with a loose leash. Now this is a martingale collar. It actually has two loops. This is where you attach the leash here. And then basically it has these two loops here. So basically you put your dog's head over this one and it can be nice and relaxed. And then when I pull the leash, it makes it tighter. So these are great for dogs like Huskies or Malamutes who have these really thick necks and small heads that often can pop the leash off of their head, or the collar off their head. Also, when it comes to collars, by the way, yeah, you're gonna go for Laura's treat pouch. We'll go ahead and get that temptation out of the way then. When it comes to collars, make sure you can always fit at least 2 fingers in the collar. If it's overly tight, that can be constrictive. And when you have puppies, make sure you're checking your dog's collar about once a week because they're gonna grow pretty fast. I've had some clients actually had to cut the collar off because it was actually starting to impede their breathing. Also, if your dog pulls a lot and it has a flat collar like this, it can collapse their trachea. And I've seen that, and that is something that is not operable and will impact your dog's ability to breathe for the rest of its life. So if that's the case, again, use a harness and find somebody that can teach you with positive reinforcement only how to teach your puppy to walk with a loose leash. Now, if you do have that Husky or an escape artist, a lot of dogs, when they're wearing a harness, if you're there where the camera is and you're holding a leash, I can kind of go like this and wiggle and escape out of it. So if that's the case, then if you pair it up with a martingale collar that's here And then you have the front clip harness. You can clip to both of these. So if they do happen to escape out of the harness, you still have the martingale collar. Now you need to make sure you size this. So what you do is you put it on your dog's head, and it should be loose when it goes on. And then you pull it like this and try to pop it off the dog's head. If you can do it, it's too loose. Martingale collar is gonna be looser than your traditional type of collar because of this special loop, that this is the martingale loop. And this is referred to as a no-slip collar because if you size it properly, the dog should not be able to pull it off their head. Now, another thing about the martingale collar is this actually can help your dog not choke itself. It's not gonna stop them. If your dog's really pulling and going crazy, that's something you need to address the behavior. But this is a safer collar to use than a traditional belt collar. It's like a belt, it's a fixed width. But again, if you have a pulling dog, be careful with that. Now, speaking of high energy breed dogs, we have a couple of booklets that we have in all of our puppy classes. These are from Puppy Culture, which I am a huge fan of Puppy Culture. This first one is basically fitness tips for puppies. A lot of people have these high energy dogs and they're like, dog's so high energy, I'm gonna take it for a 3-mile walk and burn all that energy out. Puppies and adult dogs actually sleep a lot. Exercise is best sprinkled in shorter sessions multiple times a day. So one hour walk is nowhere near as good as 3 20-minute walks that are done every 2 to 3 or 4 hours. So depending on the breed, different breeds need different amount of energy. Also, repetitive activities can also lead to injuries, especially when dogs are developing their soft tissue and their bones are not fully set. So the nice thing about this booklet is it's got a bunch of exercises in here. There can be physical stimulation, there can be mental stimulation. One of the ones we really like is scent games, which is something you can Google, and there's a lot of versions that you can do at home. But if you have a high energy dog and you're having difficulty with it, then I would recommend that you get you ask your instructor if you can borrow a copy of this. Should be at all the puppy class instructor locations that we teach at. There's also another booklet we like from Puppy Culture called Should I Spay or Neuter My Puppy? There are a lot of chemicals and there's benefits to spaying or neutering your puppy earlier or later. If you have a male dog, I would recommend not doing it too early because I find that creates a lot of humping behavior later on. And large breed dogs, typically you want to wait until they're about closer to 2 years old, but it is a personal decision. If your puppy is getting very aggressive and territorial, you might alter and I would rather suggest that you spay or neuter your dog earlier. It's usually more of an issue for males than females because aggression often comes with puberty and possessiveness of dogs and resources, and that's something that's very difficult to train out. And your puppy, you don't want them to practice that behavior. Once you remove the testicles for male dogs, it takes up to 3 weeks before the hormones leave. So if your puppy starts getting aggressive, don't wait another week or two. You'll have now 4, 5, or 6 weeks of your puppy practicing this behavior. If your puppy is getting like that, I would limit its contact to anything that acts aggressively until you can get that neutering done. If you do have a male dog, I would recommend you check with your vet, see if they can do it with a laser. A laser neutering is a bloodless surgery for males, and it heals about a third faster. So it just makes it a little bit easier. And the last little thing is, if you have a high energy dog, I cannot recommend that enough. That's what we call a long-term confinement area. A long-term confinement area is a fenced-in area in your home, preferably in a spare bedroom or in your basement, or you could do it in your laundry room, maybe a dining room that you don't use very often. You don't want to put it in your living room. You definitely don't want to put it in the doorway to your home. You don't want to put it in an unfinished basement. That would be considered a punishment for a dog. And so the idea is to find a place where the puppy can kind of have its own area. If it can see you, it's not going to go to sleep. Puppies, small breed puppies need to sleep about 12 to 14 hours a day. Large breed puppies need to sleep about 13 to 17 hours a day. And again, in my experience, most puppies are under-exercised and underslept, and they can be both at the same time. So if your puppy gets overly aggressively mouthy or biting, you walk into your long-term confinement area, you redirect them by dropping some treats or a bully stick or a cow kneecap, or one of the things we talked about, and then you walk out of there. Never lift your puppy over the fence to go in there. Make sure you get a long-term confinement area that has a door way so you can have it walk in or out. If you every time you lift it over, you're helping it practice doing that, and they'll eventually try to scale that. If your dog does try to scale it, let us know. We have a little trick on how to fix that, but you want to start the long-term confinement area as soon as you possibly can. If you start when they're 8 weeks old, my puppy Quest at 5 months old, I was able to leave him unsupervised, and he has never developed a chewing problem. That is incredibly early. I have literally dozen or more clients whose dogs have chewed up over $5,000 worth of electronics, art, furniture, etc. It happens very commonly. A long-term confinement area, even if you have a big dog, it's gonna cost you maybe $200, $300 bucks. And then you can sell that stuff for probably about half what you sell it in our Puppy Class Clearance page. It's a hell of a lot cheaper than having to replace leather couches or have your puppy develop a habit of chewing shoes or your carpet or holes in the drywall or whatever the case is. Now, one little tip about this, we are force-free and we just all about positive reinforcement. Unfortunately, there are a lot of puppy mills out there in America, and these are really horrible, horrible conditions. The ones that I've rescued dogs out of, they don't even have enough height to stand up in the kennel because they just have 150 puppies. So a lot of them, they have just what looks like that stuff on the floor, which is incredibly inappropriate, is painful for the dogs. And the reason they do it, because those people, I don't think they have much of a soul. They don't have time to clean all those kennels. So they want it just to, the poop or pee just to run down. Well, guess what? The puppies that are underneath them get a nice surprise that's not a nice surprise. Unfortunately, Midwest Dog Crates actually sells kennels that actually have that flooring in the middle of it. And in their pictures, they show pictures of dogs stacked like this. Never, ever should be the case. Dogs should always be able to stand up fully in a kennel. It should have a solid, flat surface. It should be able to extend its arms and legs. And we just can't support any company with anything. I'm not going to buy a long-term confinement area, even though they sell them from a company that sells tools that make a horrendous experience for puppies in puppy mills, which unfortunately they do. I talked to the president of the company, and he just lectured me that that's not what they're designed for. You go to their Amazon page, that's what it talks about. So we just don't believe in supporting those or supporting anything that goes to puppy mills. Now, there's other supplies and stuff that we do recommend, and they are listed in our Puppy Class Supplies page. If you can't find it, ask your instructor. They're happy to go over to it. But just go to the Puppy Class Parents page, look for those pinned posts at the top, and they'll be all linked to Amazon Chewy, and I would recommend getting as much of those as you possibly can. All right, well, this is a little bit of a summary on some of the tools. And oh, one last little thing. For leashes, we're not big fans of retractable leashes. A lot of people use retractable leashes. I would use it if I live in New York or if I have a dog that I can't control off leash, maybe in a park area. But if your dog's way, way ahead of you, and it gets around the corner and another dog off leash, I've had clients where they get attacked in that situation, though I've also seen things break all the time. So I would only use them in very limited capacities. I would regularly just get a regular straight leash. Usually a 6-foot leash is what we want. And you remember, try never to pull your dog. The more you pull your dog on the leash, the more they're gonna pull against. So a better thing to do is use a positive interrupter, like, and then your puppy to run over to you, just like Miss Ruby did. And then you reward them with giving a treat, and instead of pulling them to you, you got them to come on their own. They enjoy that experience, and the more you do that on a walk, the more they're likely to do it. We actually have a video about that. You can watch that at a different time. All right, well, these are some of the training tools and supplies that we like to use. If you have any other questions, ask your instructor.
Quest, you are a goofball.